It is our burden of proof. So the case I gave you, Mogarabi, will say testimony alone may suffice. And then later case law says corroborative evidence may be required. SMJ reiterates DAS, but says that the government is supposed to also submit background materials. And in Diallo versus INS, the IJ must assess reasonableness of an explanation of a failure to provide corroborative evidence when testimony was otherwise credible. So sometimes you're just not going to have corroboration, and you're going to have to explain why you don't have it. Maybe it's too dangerous for you to get the corroboration from your family. Maybe the activity didn't make the press locally or internationally. Credibility. The judge has, and the trier, and the asylum officer have significant deference with regard to credibility. There's a whole case called Matter of OD, which began a line which says that the submission of documents that are found to be fraudulent and are material to a claim can can undermine your entire claim. So one of the things that you want to be very, very careful with as you work with clients is ask them about the documents. And if they're not certain about the documents, you may have a strategic question as to whether to put them on or not, because these documents have been subjected to forensic examination. And whilst you might question and you may have to question the validity of the forensic conclusions that are found, you don't, if you can avoid it, want to be in that situation where you have a forensics lab saying this birth certificate is not real or not. So if it's making you wonder, you need to ask those questions to make sure. And sometimes our clients' family will send them something or something, they'll collect something, and they're not 100% sure about those documents. You may want to be very careful with those documents before you put them in. Sometimes it's better to have a whole rather than a document that can raise questions about a person's validity. So then we had a portion of the law called the Real ID Act, which has a section which says where the trier of fact determines that the application should provide evidence that corroborates otherwise credible testimony, such evidence must be provided unless the applicant does not have the evidence and cannot reasonably obtain the evidence. So I have had lots of situations where I suspect that family members in a home country can provide affidavits or of the documentation, but it is so dangerous for us to even contact them that it is not worth that risk to my client to put their family in harm's way. And that is, I think, a very good reason not to have corroborating evidence. Well, most of our clients leave with the clothes on their backs. And that's why the initial expectation was that credibility alone was enough, or the person's testimony alone, sorry, not credibility, credible testimony alone was enough. But the burden of proof has been getting higher and higher and higher. And yet still, sometimes things are just not available. And in fact, you will never get everything that you want, but you want to do as well as you can. And you can sometimes show that, for example, if you're in a country where you would have to contact someone via the internet or by telephone or by letter to try and get documents out, you could show in your evidence package that those are monitored by the government. And so to do so would put your client's family in danger. So you want to get what you can, but you don't want to put other people in danger. Credibility. And this is super important. Credibility now, based on case law and the Real ID Act, can be undermined by any inconsistency, inaccuracy, or falsehood without regard to whether these go to the heart of the applicant's claim or any other relevant issue. So something which is not material to the claim, which can undermine the case. And this is why I ask you, as you do any immigration law work, but particularly asylum work, that you look at every single document against each other. Officers are trained to look at to find small inconsistencies throughout. And now the law will allow them to make a negative credibility determination based on that. So for example, your client in his affidavit says, I ran out of the house with the shoulders behind me, and I tripped over the blue bicycle and they caught me. And in front of the asylum officer says, I ran out of the house and I tripped over the green bicycle and they caught me. Well, if the officer wanted to, she could decide that the person is not credible because of that completely immaterial inconsistency and because of the Real ID Act. Now, will they always do so? No, probably not. They will probably question, and they're supposed to question and ask about inconsistencies. And hopefully your client will say, I don't know. But why, I was you know, I don't really know what the color was of the bicycle. But why? But then, why are you in your affidavit going to write the color of the bicycle if it's not material? So be very careful of the facts you used. Every fact you use in your affidavit, although it may go to sort of show the sort of the richness of the facts, every fact is both a step, stepping stone, and a tripping, a block to trip over. So unless the fact is important, don't put it in. The fact that it's the bicycle was green or blue is immaterial. The fact it was a bicycle is immaterial. It's just not important to the case. Just say I ran over and I tripped over and or something, and I was caught by the officers. Five officers, four officers, three officers. Most of our clients often don't know exactly how many people are in rooms. And if it's not important and your client is not going to repeat it, and don't put in numbers. Be very, very careful with numbers and dates and times, and approximations are fine. None of us remember these details, and much less people who are in a traumatic situation. To ask them to remember them under the pressure of either questioning by an asylum officer or cross-examination or questioning by us in front of a judge is a lot, okay? Very, very few people have perfect dates, memory for dates. I've had one client in many, many years who had this incredible ability to remember dates with a scary precision. You'd say, she'd say, oh, that happened on, you know, August 5th, 1999, and you'd go, you'd look at them and say, she says, it was a Thursday. You'd look in your calendar or on your phone, and it was indeed a Thursday. She had a perfect recall for dates. Not other facts, by the way, but dates, absolutely. Absolutely, absolutely, absolutely. So after I confirmed this would happen every single time, I left most of the dates in that one because I was just waiting for the officer to have the Thursday conversation because it never failed. But that's happened once in 22 years of practice. I was confident that my client would remember every single date she ever proffered. Most of our clients can't. If they know that they were arrested on the 15th of June, that's fine, but mid-June would be fine as well. Because while you're in the pressure of testimony, if you say 15th of June in your affidavit and you say the 16th, or your papers say the 16th, you might be found inconsistent, where if you say mid-June and the piece of paper says June 15th or June 16th or June 17th, you haven't actually contradicted yourself. So look for those contradictions both internally and externally. If your client says that they were being jailed on the 5th, you better look through their passport, because if they're visiting the 5th of May, if their passport says they're in Burkina Faso between the 10th, the 4th and the 10th of May, that's going to undermine your application. And you want to be very, very careful about that. So you want to catch that before the asylum officer or the judge or the government attorney does. Look at all the documents against each other obsessively and carefully. So, what can stop you? Yes?
Just a quick question. So when dealing with the testimony of children whose recall is often not great and they often conflict their own testimony, so how do you really, does the court consider that?
Adults do as well, and the courts are supposed to, and I think that's what the second part of this training will be all about. You know, we think of adults, we think of ourselves as accurate reporters. We're miserable. Adults are miserable reporters. We forget things, we see things in ways which are most helpful to us, which in fact is the way that everyone sees things. Two people can see the exact same event and describe it completely differently, and neither of them is lying. And this is what we're expected, or our clients are expected, to recall traumatic events from 5, 10, even 10 minutes ago, with absolute detail, which is almost impossible. And so we have to be able to try and help them along as well as we can, and not put them in a situation where they're going to trip themselves up, not because they're lying, not because they're even trying to lie, but because we are human. Yes?
Can you appeal adverse credibility findings?
It's very difficult.
Okay.
Yeah. So what will stop you from getting asylum? The one which often is a problem for us is the one-year filing deadline, which says that that people have to apply within a year of entry. And there are only a couple of ways around this. You can show that circumstances have changed relevant to the asylum application, and that you're now in more danger. So the first example I gave, where the person had been here for 20 years as a consular officer, and then suddenly things go bad in their country, things have changed. But then you have a reasonable time to file after that, not the 1 year, and reasonable has been seen to be about 6 months. Or let's say you're transgender and you go through some form of surgery or hormone treatment, which is medical, which is formal and medical, you might, even though you have been in a long process, you could assert that that is a change that is so significant in your life that that is sufficient for a change circumstance to overcome a 1 year filing deadline. I've done it with 13 years after the of entry and managed to get the asylum office or the courts to agree with me. Okay, so change circumstances in your personal or in country conditions such that you are now in greater danger or suddenly in danger will give you the opportunity to file after the 1 year and within a reasonable time, which is about 6 months. Or extraordinary circumstances. These are circumstances that would stop you from filing the asylum application itself. You're in a coma. Can't file. Okay, that's the easiest one. But you also might have been in lawful status for a long time, and there you're not really expected to file while you're in lawful status because you may be seeing if things get better, and the government doesn't want to rush you into filing in that situation. But then after that status goes away, you've got a reasonable time, about 6 months. Or you have a combination of you've been trafficked, you're homeless, you have intense trauma, which you are working through. Those are all extraordinary circumstances that would stop you from filing. I had one client who really could not file until after a decade of therapy. And I had really good evidence from his psychologist and psychiatrist. And to say, this person just simply could not file before this, even though a decade had happened. And he'd gone to other lawyers and not been able to work with those. Oh, ineffective assistance of counsel can be an extraordinary circumstance. Being defrauded by persons who are non-lawyers or by lawyers as well. These can all be pulled together. And sometimes you have to, in fact, make this sort of web of reasons as to why someone could not file before. And sometimes it's both changed and extraordinary circumstances. If your prior asylum application on the same grounds have been denied, but that denial has to be final denial. So it has to go up through a board denial or the failure to appeal. So it's not at the asylum office. So if the case is denied at the asylum office and doesn't go any further, you still can file again. Some people are barred from relief. If you're the persecutor, you're barred from relief. But then here again, what is a persecutor is very important. And we don't have enough time to go into it, but you have to read the law very carefully. Just because you work for an organization that persecutes people does not mean you're a persecutor. Or it may with certain jobs. So you have to be very, very, very cognizant of the case law. Being convicted of particular serious crimes or serious non-political crimes conviction in the United States, that includes aggravated felonies, or commission of a serious non-political crime outside the United States can bar you from asylum. Being a danger to security, falling under the enormously broad definition of terrorism, which includes someone who has provided material support to terrorism. There may be ways of getting around that, but under our law, if the guerrillas come by your house, put a gun to your head and say, I would like some milk, and you give them some milk, you may, in fact, have materially supported terrorism. So you want to be very, very careful about that. You have to ask those questions because there's going to be an assumption that if you're living in certain places, you're going to be in that sort of trouble. Being firmly resettled. Firmly resettled means that you have been offered something akin to lawful permanent residence in another country in which you can work and be there. It's been slightly made softer by recent case law. A frivolous prior application. One thing which is not here and should be is something called a safe third country agreement. There is only one that is current, and that is the decision between the United States and Canada that wherever you land is where you're supposed to make the asylum application. So if you come to the United States, you land here in New York, and you travel up to Canada, and you make an application in Canada, you will be taken back to the border and handed into the hands of US ICE at the border, or CBP, and then you'll be put in removal, and you'll have to apply here, and likewise the other way. Okay, safe third country and firmly resettled are often confused. They are completely different. One is a treaty between two countries, and the other one is being offered residency or something akin to residency in another country. bars are very important. You have to ask a person about crimes. The application asks. But things which are not particularly serious crimes will not bar asylum, but they might go to discretion. So if the person has a string of low-grade arrests, that could, in certain circumstances, have the adjudicator decide that she is not eligible for asylum on the in the exercise of discretion. There's a very good case called Matter of Pula that says that it has to be quite serious, that exercise of discretion. So it's another good case to read. Withholding of removal. Remember we said asylum is a reasonable person would be afraid, and you have to show subjective of an objective fear, and it's a 1 in 10 chance of harm. With withholding of removal, it's more likely than not. If you can show that the harm is more likely than not on account of one of the five protected grounds, then there is no discretion for the adjudicator, and in this case, only the immigration judge, because withholding only happens in court. The adjudicator cannot send you back. The problem is it's withholding of removal, and so it's withholding a removal order, and so you've been ordered removed, but it's being withheld. You still are safe here, but unfortunately, you don't get as many benefits as you would with asylum. But it is non-discretionary. What are the differences? Asylum is discretionary, withholding is not. Asylum is based on past persecution or well-founded fear of persecution. Withholding is largely forward-looking, although past persecution will also give you a presumption or will move things forward. Asylum has to be filed within a year without the changed or exceptional extraordinary circumstances. With withholding, there's no one-year rule. Asylum, you can travel on a refugee travel document except to the country of harm. Withholding, you cannot travel outside the country because you have a removal order, and the second you put your toe out of the country, you have in fact executed that order and therefore cannot come back. Asylum, you can petition for spouses, well, it's one spouse and children, and derivative for withholding, there's no relief available. And this can be significant because you might have a situation where you have a family and you have children or a spouse, and the principal applicant may have applied for asylum and withholding and included their derivatives and may lose asylum in court and only get withholding. That petitioning spouse will get withholding. The other folks are out of luck unless they have independent claims of themselves. Asylum, you're eligible for lawful permanent residence after a year. And withholding, you cannot adjust status based on the withholding. You also have relief under the Convention Against Torture. This is the withholding standard. So if you can show that it's more likely than not that you would be tortured for, and what's helpful here is you might have be in a situation where it's really impossible for you to show that the harm is on account of one of the five grounds. That's not required for withholding. It can be for any reason based on discrimination of any kind. So that's a much broader reason for the harm. But that it has to be torture. It's generally in the hands of the government under the government's control, but it also can be with the acquiescence of the government if the government knows about it and does nothing. And here, again, it's a withholding standard, which means that if it is more likely than not that you'll be tortured, you cannot be sent back. But the US provides sort of two different sort of types of CAT relief. One is called deferral of removal, and the other one's called withholding of removal. The withholding one is the one which we just spoke about, or similar to it, where you cannot be sent back to that country. You are here, you have work authorization. Deferral of removal is they won't send you back to that country, but they often will keep you detained until they figure out who else will take you. Yes?
Is the withholding terms the same under CAT and withholding of removal?
Yeah, I mean, they're very similar standards. But again, with withholding of removal, not non-CAT withholding of removal, you have to show that the harm is on account of one of the five protected grounds. With CAT, you don't. No.
Okay.
Because again, removal is being withheld. An order is there which will be executed when you leave the country.